Good morning, church. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord on this, the 3rd of May? Can you believe it? We've reached May. And this morning, we have some great word for you. We know because we've already preached it and we've sat in it, and we have a great expectation that God is going to use the word. We have a real anointed preacher. Unfortunately, it's not a minister, it's not a pastor, it's someone who's in the laity. You might know him, you might not know him. His name is Patrick Nelson. And so if you do know him, that's great. So don't let that steal your expectation. We have heard the word, it is a good word. And we pray that God would do something extraordinary for you. We pray that God would open up your hearts to the word of God today. So we want to welcome you, church. We want to welcome you to our celebration service. Isn't it great to know that God has risen and risen indeed, and that Christ is in our hearts? And so we pray this morning that God would do something for us. Are you ready for a movement of God's Spirit? What are you focusing on? Have you got your laser focus as we lock in on Jesus, church? And as we challenge you on that, I want to just ask you to bow your heads, and shall we open this service in prayer? Let's seek God's face, shall we? Almighty Father, Father God, we are grateful for who you are in our lives. And Father God, we pray that you would use this time, that as we gather together, wherever we may be, Lord, we understand that we are not alone with you, that you are there with us. And even though we might be far from each other, and we might be apart and separate, we remain one body through the power, the resurrecting power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And so, Lord, we pray that you would be with us during the course of the service, and that, Lord, above all, that we wouldn't, Father, just get this feeling of great enjoyment, but Lord, we would be gravely challenged, and may we accept the challenge of your word, and then may we be doers of the word. And so, Holy Spirit, we give you freedom. We give you freedom, Holy Spirit, to etch on our hearts the challenge that you have for us today. Father, we are aware that it is a grave challenge, it is a big challenge. So, Father, give us the faith to live it. And now, Lord, may you receive all the glory of this service and indeed our lives. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
I light this candle as a symbol of Jesus Christ's light he brought into the world. Today, we recognize Jesus Christ, the light of the world, and his ultimate sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. Let us bring the basket of salvation, and each and every one of us as fellow believer, let's raise hands and pray for them. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We bring all the names of our fellow brothers and sisters, old and young, that, Lord, we have seen them far from you, Lord. All we need, we pray for them. May the Holy Spirit touch them. May the blood of Jesus soak each and every name that is in here, and we bring them back home. Lord, may you be with them. Touch them with your healing hand to come back home. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
It's now the time we take up the tithes and offerings, and we, as we usually come around and collect it physically, we aren't able to do that today. So we just pray that you are able to do an EFT, maybe a bank transfer. If you can't do that, we just challenge you, put it in an envelope, keep it aside, and then hopefully one day when we can all get together again after this lockdown period, we can just share those offerings and we can bring them to the house of the Lord. Let us just pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you're the great provider, and even through our difficult times, you're always there, you always provide for us. And so, Lord, now as we just offer up these offerings and our tithes, Lord, we just pray that they will be used wisely to further your kingdom here on earth and to bring you glory and honor. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Yeah. Good morning, all. As we sit here under lockdown, we still are not allowed to meet in person. We try to stay in contact with friends and family, and we wonder how much longer it will be before we can visit. I've heard plenty of rumours, differing opinions, everybody trying to second guess the government as to what should or should not happen. So what are we going to talk about today? I want to talk about something I believe is going to be very important in this year to come. Giving. What do we mean by giving? In the church terms, there's two components to giving: tithing and free will giving. I thought we'd start with tithing first. What is tithing? According to the Oxford Dictionary, giving 1/10 of one's annual produce or earnings. It goes on to say it was formerly taken as a tax for the support of the church and clergy. The process of tithing, the practice of giving or paying a tithe. As I was doing my research in the Bible, I came across between 31 and 45 references to tithing. The reason for the difference, it depended which version of the Bible I was reading. The principle still, however, is the same. We need to give 1/10 of what we earn to the church. You don't pay on what you earned last year, you're paying what you're earning this year. So what you had left last year is still yours. If we read in Leviticus 27, verses 30 to 32, we read the following. And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. If a man wants to redeem any of his tithes, he shall add 1/5 to it. And concerning the tithe of the herd or the flock, whatever passes under the rod, the tenth shall be holy to the Lord. He shall not inquire whether it is good or bad, nor shall he exchange it. And if he exchanges it at all, then both it and the one exchanged shall both be holy. It shall not be redeemed. We go on further in Numbers 18, verses 21 to 24. Behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tithes in Israel as an inheritance in return for the work which they perform, the work of the tabernacle of meeting. Hereafter, the children of Israel shall not come near the tabernacle of meeting, lest they bear sin and die. But the Levites shall perform the work of the tabernacle of meeting, and they shall bear the iniquity. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations, that among the children of Israel they shall have no inheritance. For the tithes of the children of Israel, which they offer up as a heave offering to the Lord, I have given to the Levites as an inheritance. Therefore I have said to them, among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance. So we are to give a tenth to the priests. The first tenth, not what remains after we have taken what we want, nor the damaged or deformed produce. The choice part. The priests were to live on this portion, as they received no land when the land of Israel was divided amongst the tribes. This was their portion. This is what the priests had to do God's work, along with any special offerings. They fed the widows and the orphans from this alongside themselves. Remember, at the time the culture was, if your brother died, you took in his family. You looked after his family. It was only when there was no family left that the priests had to step in. So we're not excused from looking after our own family. We then get to the New Testament. In the New Testament, we have a lot of people who feel the law has been done away with and we no longer have to tithe. This is not so. we still need to obey the law, although some of the laws have been put aside. I think in particular, the one of that we can now eat anything. We're not limited in what we can eat. We can marry people outside of the Jewish faith. But there's also in this a proviso that we do not cause our fellow Christian to stumble when we do. But back to tithing. Our churches, our pastors, have just as much need today as the priests of old did for our tithes. It is needed for the church to continue functioning, for the pastor and his family to eat. We no longer drive up here on a Sunday morning with a bucky load of millies to the church as a tithe. We sell it. And then we bring a tenth of the money in. In Acts 2:45, we have the following. It reads as such. And sold their possessions and goods and divided among them, among all, as anyone had need. And again, later in the book of Acts, Acts 4, verses 34 and 35. Nor was there anyone among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands and all houses sold them and brought the proceeds of things that were sold and laid them at the apostles' feet, and they distributed to each as anyone had need. As we read this, it's moved beyond tithing. So where does this leave us? I believe we still need to tithe, both because the Bible tells us to, and because we need to support the church and through the church the needy people. I've tithed over the years. When I've had income, I've tithed. When I haven't, obviously not. I never found that I've been short of what I need. Please note, need, not want. I think we all have a list of things we would like to have, and sometimes manage to move these items to needs, no longer wants. We all have the ability to find reasons for this. We also then use these same reasons to be able to justify why we can't tithe in full. Now, in the middle of lockdown, we sit with a difficulty. We can't see what the church is doing. We're not allowed to go and see. So we don't see the pastor. Some of us have been retrenched, some suspended until the lockdown is over. Others have had to tackle pay cuts. Some have businesses that have had no sales due to being closed. For a lot of small businesses, this means no salary for the owner and often staff. My brother has two friends who own small businesses who had to tell their staff, sorry, we cannot pay you. They had not put aside to prepare for this. They normally save up for their December closing, but they didn't have anything put aside for this. They paid them what they could. Let us go back to the Old Testament, Nehemiah 13. In Nehemiah 13, verse 4, we read, and before this, Elisha, the priest, who was set over the rooms of the house of our God, and who was related to Tobiah, and he had prepared for himself a large room where they had in the days of old laid the food offering, the frankincense, the vessels, and the tithes of the grain, the new wine and the oil, which was commanded to be given to the Levites and the singers and the gatekeepers and the offerings of the priests. But in all this time I was not in Jerusalem, for in the 32nd year of Xerxes, king of Babylon, I came to the king, and after some days I was given permission to leave the king. And I came to Jerusalem and understood the evil which Elishabib had done for Tobiah, in preparing him a room in the courts of the house of God. And it grieved me very much, and I threw all the household stuff of Tobiah out of the room. Then I commanded, and they purified the rooms. And I brought there again the vessels of the house of God, and with the food offering and the frankincense. And I saw that the portions of the Levites had not been given to them, who did the work, and fled each one to his field. Now, as we today have not been to church for now more than a month, we run the risk, if we are not tithing, that we'll face the same thing when we get to church. The pastors and staff might have left due to no salary, as they still need to eat. And they probably had to find other sources of food and money. I know I would like to come back to the church as I know it, full of familiar faces, pastors I know, and the building still available as a church. This is what Nehemiah had to face when he returned to Jerusalem after an absence. So please do not neglect the church at this time. Now, if you remember back to last week's sermon, Pastor Onkel spoke about tithing as well. Because it's not just money. It can also be our time, our skills, our talents. Are we prepared to offer up a Saturday to help paint the church? Our skills as an electrician to repair something, computer skills to develop a website. This list can be endless. We all have something we can contribute over and above money. And sometimes it's not just for the church. Sometimes we called to help fellow congregation members in the same way. This is all giving to God. However, I do believe helping your own family does not count. That we are obliged to. Think back in the Old Testament, how they used to have to bring their brother's wife into their home when he passed away. I came across this short story about tithing. Dr. Russell Conwell, one night at a prayer meeting, asked if there were any tithers present who had tithed through a series of years. Seven people stood up. He asked for a testimony from each one. Of them, in emphasis of the fact of God's faithfulness in blessing them. Six gave radiant blessings of testimonies received and what they'd happened. The seventh was a frail, grey-haired woman who spoke with much reluctance. I wish I could bear such testimony, but I cannot. I have skimped and saved and denied myself through the years to keep a vow made to tithe my income. But now I'm old and I'm losing my position. I have no means of support. I do not know what I shall do. She sat down and the meeting was closed in the midst of a profound and distressing chill. The next day, Dr. Conwell had an invitation from Mr. John Wanamaker to dine with him. At the table, Mr. Wanamaker said, "I think you will be interested to know we are about to inaugurate a pension system for our employees. The plan has been worked out. We are to issue our first life pension today to a woman who has served us for 25 years. He mentioned her name, and it was that of the woman who had given the pessimistic testimony the night before. God honours us in our tithe. We now move on to giving. Tithing and giving are not very different. We tithe because we are commanded to, because we want to return just that small portion back to the Lord. We give because of our love for the Lord. We give over and above our 10%. This is where, when we bless somebody in the church, when we help the beggar in town, when we stop on the side of the road and help the person who's broken down, there's so many opportunities to give. Just like tithing, it is not just money. It's time, it's talents, it's possessions. Going out of your way to give somebody a lift, to buy somebody at lunch who forgot theirs, to give somebody a jacket in winter when they are cold. But it is not always somebody in need. Sometimes God wants you to bless somebody over and above their needs. But to me, we are going into a period now. We are going to be tested in both these areas. As I've mentioned earlier, people have lost jobs, lost part of their incomes. Businesses are under strain and losing money. We're going to be challenged to more than what we normally do. More than we think we can. We're going to have to trust God as never before. We're going to have to look at different ways to do things. It might not be giving a family food to cook. It might be giving them a bag of dog food so that they can spend the money on food for themselves. People are going to be in places that they never planned to be. We all started this year with plans for holidays, birthdays, school trips, innumerable plans. I don't think any of these has survived up until today. We do not know when we are going to be able to go on holiday again. But we need to spare a thought for the person who owns the holiday venue and has staff. The restaurant round the corner that you used to go when you were too lazy to cook, his staff. There's a number of non-essential areas that are going to need our support in some way that we can. I was just speaking the other day to a man who runs a horse riding school round the corner from me. It's aimed at children. And all of the parents have cancelled their classes and not paid because they don't have the income. He, however, faces the problem of where does he get food for the horses and how does he pay for it? Where is the money going to come from for him? We are going to be asked to help people we are not expecting to need to help. God expects us to help them where and how we can. In 1 John 3, verse 16, it reads as follows. By this we have known the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. It goes on in verse 17 and 18. But whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother having need and shuts his bowels from him, how does the love of God dwell in him? My children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and truth. We also need to realize it's not for us to decide how much or what to give. The person we are helping knows what they need. God can give us guidance. As we close today, I think I've left you with a number of points to look at. I'd like us all to review how we're using what God has blessed us with and how we can possibly help others with what we have. I believe we're going to be asked for a lot in the year to come. Let us be the Christians God wants us to be. Now let us just close in prayer. Father God, we just thank you for the overwhelming blessings you have given to us in our lives. We thank you for the provision you have blessed us with. We thank you for the houses that we stay in. And Father, we just pray that as you ask us in this year to spread some of that bounty, that we do so willingly, happily, and say, please, Lord, let me serve. Because you, Lord, need us to do this for you. And we pray that none that we know shall be found needy without us helping in whatever small way we can. So we pray today, Lord, that you will take our tithes and our offerings that we have brought to the church, multiply them, supplement them from with what we have, and bless the community around us. We pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Almighty Father, we are grateful for your grace that is free for us every day. And Father, as we come before you, we are mindful that this table does not belong to any denomination. And Father, we thank you for the grace of Jesus Christ. And so, Father, as we come to remember the body and the blood of our Lord and our Saviour Jesus Christ, we pray, Lord, that this table, this means of grace, would be exactly what you ordained for it to be. A time of revelation. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Father God, we welcome you. Lord Jesus, we welcome you. And so, Father, we pray that you would consecrate these elements that are being prepared here. And that, Father, that as we partake as your church, we pray that you would consecrate all the elements as we electronically partake, Lord, that have been prepared as we would remember Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Thank you, Lord, for the body and the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. So in our church, we're going to partake together. And so on the night that the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and after breaking it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. The body of Jesus Christ. 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 And the body of Jesus Christ. Likewise, after taking the cup, he blessed it. And then he said to them, take, drink, this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. What a glorious time as we celebrate the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ for you. The blood of Jesus Christ for you, Pastor Trevor. The blood of Jesus Christ for you, Pastor Uncle. The blood of Jesus Christ for you, Pastor Josiah.
Blood of Christ for you.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you at this time that we are able to partake in these elements wherever we are. We do this in remembrance of you and for the sacrifice that your Son, who died for us on the cross of Calvary. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
What's to say? Will we just have the elements, please? And so, church, as we close this service, we are mindful that Christ has challenged us. That in this time of COVID-19, as we walk out of it, we have a great expectation that God is going to use us, that we're going to be a group of givers, not takers.
Yes.
We thank Patrick for his word, but we are greatly challenged. We are greatly challenged because we know that our flesh is exactly contrary to that. And so we pray for the empowering of the Holy Spirit, that we can be the church that Christ has ordained for us to be. But for by the grace of God, there go I. And so now shall we receive a benediction. And now, church, may the love of the Father, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and indeed the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with every single one of us as we realize we are not God and you are Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Have a great week with God. Be blessed out of your socks, church.